What we did is we listed discussion by vote, other action, as we always do, but we didn't put the word amendment. Had we had the word amendment on the agenda, none of this would have been happening. Because the Attorney General did not, that was the only violation that the Attorney General found. Okay, they didn't find, as a matter of fact, let me just look at my notes real quick. Matter of fact, the Attorney General, excuse me, one second. All right, the Attorney General said that we should have had a discussion vote if we did have that word in the agenda. The Attorney General even went one step further, and they said, town clerk, that we did not knowingly or willfully violate the Open Meetings Act. If they felt that we did willfully violate the Open Meetings Act, then that vote that we took would have been null and void. But they didn't say that. They said that this was just a technical error that can be fixed by revoting, by reposting, re-advertising, open up the public hearing, and have another vote. That's what the remedy that was agreed to with the Attorney General, Mr. Iglesias. Okay, and that is exactly what we're doing right now. On December 20th, Mr. Clifford sent an email to the Attorney General asking him to reconsider the problem. He wasn't satisfied with that remedy. But the Attorney General responded on December 21st, basically saying that they're good with that. However, he has a right to pursue this in Superior Court if he chooses. Okay? Which, by the way, he did threaten that he would do in an email dated December 16th. He said, if we did not resolve this in a mutually acceptable manner, in other words, if we not do, not resolve it the way he wanted us to do, he would take the town to court.
Could you read verbatim what I wrote, please?
Yeah, I will.
The whole thing?
I got it right here.
Can we ask the legal question?
I got it right here. You cannot discuss with them. Question the solicitor directly. Give me one second. It's not as quite as organized as you, but I have it. Here we go. On your email dated December 16th that I received at 8:52 a.m., you put that we chose this path in the hopes of resolving the situation in a mutually acceptable manner without the need of costly litigation. To me, that sounds like the kind of threatening as well as a lawsuit. Okay. The Attorney General's ruling has given you the opportunity to resolve this issue without litigation. That was your email. So, is that okay that I read that?
Yeah, I appreciate you reading it because it's a different spin than what you put on the first statement. Can I ask
It's exactly what I put on there. You know what? You're not the sixth member of the council, okay? We're not going to debate with you. Your time is over. Okay? Right. We're going to move on to council. The council will debate. And that's it.
Could the solicitor give an opinion as to whether this violates the charter, your votes? When you vote, if you vote to amend the budget now, are you violating the charter?
Mr. President, just so we're clear, the Attorney General case is closed. We vote on these two matters. Just want to be clear. Voting on those two matters closes the Attorney General's action.
Nobody wants to ask that question.
Just stay in his hands. The Attorney General made the decision that the matter is closed. You have a right to bring it up in Superior Court. We know that you have an attorney, so you're welcome to do that. All right, so now we're going to move on now. Does anybody else for further discussion? Anybody else have anything else that they would like to discuss? Nobody? Okay, now the Attorney General, the agreement that was made was that we reschedule, repost, reopen the public hearing, and now we are going to revote, just as the agreement was made. So we have a motion, and we have a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mrs. Bottomoli?
Yes.
Mr. Yes. Okay, the motion passes.
C.
Yes, Mr. President, I make a motion to discuss by council vote about other action on reconsideration, revoke, and ratification of amendment made on July 17, 2017, to the method of tax collection by increasing it by $100,000 for the minimum tax levy of $34,325,000 and a maximum of $34,375,000. Remedy to correct technical notice violation of Open Meeting Act pursuant to OM-17-35. That's for discussion.
Motion. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? Okay, once again, I will ask you, think of this vote as you would back in July 17. Okay, with the, looking through the prism, as you call it, of us being back in July 17, not that in 2020 hindsight that you have now. Any further discussion?
Again, Mr. President, just again, the reason we're in this position, because the word amendment was not in the original, agenda. So that's basically what it is. We're acting on the advice of the Attorney General's office.
Right, these are, this is a vote to remedy the technical violation of the Open Meeting Act.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion.
Any further discussion? Any questions?
Roll call, Mr. President.
Roll call.
Mrs. Bonneville?
Yes.
Mr. McGee?
Yes.
Mrs. O'Hara?
Yes.
Mr. Swanson?
Yes.
Mr. Biergad?
Yes. Okay, moving on. Discussion by council vote on other action on line item, the town council budget with an appropriation of $100,000 as potential replacement for state aid to education designated as school aid replacement contingency. And consider action including but not limited to retain school aid replacement contingency account, reallocate to unassigned fund balance, commonly referred to as reserve, provide a tax refund, or provide a taxpayer credit. Unlike the other votes, this one is in the presentation. I think we were reporting in the here and now. We have $100,000 now. The question is, what are we going to do?
Mr. President, I just want to add that this matter was added at the behest of the administrative yourself.
Can you mic it for, please?
Sorry. This matter was added at the behest of the administrator yourself.
This is not a requirement from the Attorney General's office.
This is a matter to give an opportunity to discuss what should be done with the money now.
That's a motion. I'll make the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion.
Discussion?
Yes.
Administrator, heard now that you work with the president on this. There are pros and cons to all four of these. Are you prepared, or can your finance director explain the cost associated with them?
Absolutely. Retaining the school aid replacement contingency account has no cost. It keeps the $100,000 in the account as designated in July and as you affirmed earlier tonight. Reallocate to the unassigned fund balance also again has no impact. Reallocated to the unassigned fund balance, commonly referred to as a reserve. Providing a taxpayer refund or a taxpayer credit, as best we can tell, would be in a $4,000 to $5,000 range in terms of cost, in my opinion.
So
next year's budget, 2018-2019, is there some way that that $100,000 can be removed from the levy of taxes when we look at it? May-June period?
I think that's a legal question, not a county question. What happens in some of this is that we get into very complicated circumstances of you send the money back. We probably had 400 properties change hands in the time that this has transpired. Who gets the rebate? How do you allocate that rebate? Those become the challenges that any of those last two issues get into.
It would be an easy thing if someone walked into the tax collector's office to do a manual discount rebate refund. People that use lock boxes, we can't do that. As you said, there's been transfer of properties. So help me understand, because I'm not a CPA. If we came up with a minimum and maximum tax levy next year, I'm just going to throw numbers out there, let's say $36 million. At the end, could we take that $100,000, which is in our surplus contingency fund, and reduce that amount of payment, or that amount of taxation on the 2018-2019? Can that be done? Is there a CPA in the room?
Yes.
I'm sorry, Cindy, you can handle it.
No,
I didn't mean
that. I was just thinking.
Sorry, Cindy.
It's okay.
I guess Jim Lombardi acting as a CPA right now. Of course, you can do that. The problem is in the subsequent year, you're going to be $100,000 off of the same thing off the top of my head. So if you had a one-time expense next year and reduced it by the 100, then that would all balance out. Does that make sense?
No, okay. Do more definitely.
So if you reduced the budget by $100,000 next year and had a valid year-over-year expense, the subsequent year you'd be off 100, right? Because you'd be using a surplus to pay a current expense that time goes. If you had a one-time capital, say, expense, you need to buy a truck. Next year in the budget, you're going to buy a truck or do a capital reinvestment or do something, and you took the $100,000 from there, then I can think you'd be all set. So you could reduce it, just to show where you're doing it, but it can't be a year-over-year expense. That makes sense.
I have a question, Mr. Lombardi.
Yes.
If next year we decide to get aggressive, right?
Yes.
So we slash salaries, we slash capital funds, we slash everything. The tax rate will go down, wouldn't it?
Yes.
So we're starting.
Oh, could go down, yes.
Right. So we're starting. That the $100,000 doesn't mean anything for the following year.
Correct.
Because we start from scratch at the beginning of every budget.
Correct.
Well, my concern is this $100,000 right now.
When have we ever lowered the budget? Does that ever happen in this town? Because I'm not aware of that.
That was a theoretical question.
Oh, theoretical.
Sorry. Just perfect world.
Yeah, right.
Sorry, Mr. McGee. What you're saying, if we give back the credit, like this is what I did this, and I'm trying to make sense out of it. It's two sides. I'm on the fence with things, but I'm just looking at it as, you know something? We have a situation. We needed $100,000. We looked at it. We all agreed, let's do this. We did it for the better of our town and schools. We find out we didn't need it. I don't know. I got a bad taste in my mouth that we just said, hey, I'm going to keep it. I just think that, let's be fair, we took it because we needed it. We don't need it anymore. I feel like right thing is to correct it, in my opinion. That's what I feel like, you know? I mean, $100,000, it's not a lot of money, whether it goes to contingency or the other way. But for the fight, the legal problems we're gonna have out of this, I think that's the way out, in my opinion. It's not gonna make our fund balance so much greater for $100,000. And if we can make everything go away and everything, sandbox, I think it would be best thing to do, in my opinion. That's all I need to say. But I mean, I don't understand, we can't give a credit, because some people might not be able to buy, is that what it is?
Serious business sales from beer holes, changing vans, and holes. A lot of them are service companies that are escrowed. Who do we give to for lodging, who do we, what service company? It's a lot of manpower, a lot of work on our own, so we just do all this.
So is it?
Yeah, do it, tell us to do.
Is it gonna cost, how much would you think it was costing to give the money back?
Well, it's $4,500 for just, not talking about mine.
For, to give money back, but how much as a credit, as a?
As a credit, $262,000 house would even.
No, but I, no, I don't mean that, I mean, how? But I, it's still gonna cost $2,500 to, we're still losing $2,500.
Oh, to give you a credit?
To give everyone a credit.
Well, yeah, there will be a paper involved, that's what they say.
Right.
And no postage, so.
So.
He's saying it would be transferred to next year or something.
Right, we transfer to next year.
That's what I was asking. That's, Tom, I was asking this.
I know you were, I know, I was trying to get you, but I.
You're right, in the same way, but.
Yes, so that's what I'm saying, is it, does it cost anything to say, hey, we go in to pay our taxes, we got a credit, this house got $14 off or whatever it was? Is that, is there any?
There's a cost, yes, there's a cost, but first of all, we gotta contact them, we'll open house to raise something in the background. So there is a cost to the program, and yes, there is, and on our time.
So.
It's gonna be a lot of.
Yes, you may.
Yeah, and you have to communicate to taxpayers, and if somebody changed the income, you're up, you have to credit.
Because again, like Mr. Gerton, I don't wanna lose $5,000 either, you know? But I'm torn on, you know, I wanna do the right thing. But I wish I would have that. I don't understand how it would be so much money to give a credit.
Can I just kick in on this one? First of all, I think you're considering their time. They have normal, you have to go and get all this out, whether it's programming, you know, they're not an army of people working in these offices. So if someone taking on one thing to do the other, it's gonna be some suffering for, if we have to do the billions, it's gonna do a cost over time to get people to accept it. Now, you know, you say it's $14, round off to $15, isn't the whole cost? Especially as far as house being sold, finding people, the whole nine yards. And that goes into even more, a more complex situation. I am wondering, the second, reallocate to the unassigned fund balance commonly known as, to our reserve. Now, you know, we've spoken about the reserve before, and it's very important. It's like when you have a home, you should make sure you have so much in this reserve in case it would be needed to actually be able to function your home. The town's the same way. We stand in what area on the society as far as that reserve is concerned? Which isn't, I don't think it's frivolous, I think it's important.
Report that the council has been provided in the past indicates from our financial advisor, PFM, that we are well below the median. The median unassigned reserve in 19 similar communities, virtually half the state, and not Providence or, you know, the more challenging budget circumstances, but communities just like ours.